On Larry King Now,
a two-time Oscar nominee, Jeremy Renner. You know why you wanted to act?
For me, the stage was a safe place to hide in a character and express a lot of inner turmoil. It's hard as a man in a small agricultural town to ultimately have all these emotions. I mean, I was sitting at a table not like this with Brad Bird and the producer and Tom Cruise. I'm like, why do you want me in this? I don't get it. He's like, here's why. Boom, 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 boom. They said three things. I'm like, that makes sense. Okay, yes, I'll do your book. I like things that challenge me. I like to be challenged. If I have to go to work and I already know the answers, I'm already bored. I'm not going to turn in a good performance. I'm not going to get 100%. So I want to go and learn. I want to not know the answers. I'm willing to fail every day.
Plus,
because I did the Avengers, now I have like five-year-olds run up to me. That is the coolest thing ever, by the way. Yeah. I mean, the innocence of a child running up to you, like with a little bow and arrow, they want you to sign a thing. It's a lovely thing.
All next on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now, a two-time Oscar nominee for his roles in The Hurt Locker and The Town. Jeremy Renner has also starred in major blockbusters like The Avengers, Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol, The Bourne Legacy, and The Wonderful American Hustle, just to name a few. Next, he tackles the role of journalist Gary Webb in Kill the Messenger, due in theaters October 10th. I saw it yesterday, a terrific movie. It's so well, you produced it too, right?
Yeah.
So well done. I congratulate you.
Thank you.
You're back to acting now.
I'm back to acting again, yeah.
Now, we were talking before we went on, when I read a bio of you years ago, you fix up houses and sell them, right?
Yeah, that's been a great sort of outlet for me creatively and even financially. It's a great place for me to spend
my time.
How
did you get into that?
Fell into it with my brother. We both came into very little money, and somehow we got a loan and just wanted to not pay rent anymore. So we bought this little house and then fixed it up what we wanted to do it, you know, not a lot. And then someone offered us twice what we paid for it 10 months later. I'm like, oh, okay. Wow, we just came into a lot of money, more than we've ever seen in our life. And then we took that money and turned another house and then 20 some odd houses later,
You don't have to do it anymore, but you still do it, right? You don't
still
have to do it.
It
financially.
No, but I do it just, I mean, I've always, I mean, look, I guess, I mean, if it cost me money, I wouldn't be doing it.
But you love it.
But I would probably do it if I broke even.
Really?
Yeah. I'd probably still do it if I broke even.
Do you enjoy it as much as acting?
In a different way, yeah, absolutely.
Because it's creative, right?
Because it's very creative, yeah. I mean, it's the closest thing to, I think, producing a movie is building a house. It's a critical order to things. You have to be very good at making decisions very quickly, put out fires, how to come up with solutions to everything.
You struggled a lot, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you auditioned a lot.
Yeah.
Got rejected a lot?
Of course, yeah.
What kept you going?
I knew since I was 19 what I wanted, and I wasn't going to stop until I got it, and I gave myself a certain amount of time to achieve that.
Where'd you grow up?
Northern California, Modesto.
Oh, north of, oh, Modesto. That's
Modesto, yes. Yeah.
That's a raisin, right? Country.
Well, it's agriculture. It's like there's almonds and peaches and all that stuff.
You know why you want that act?
Well, yeah, initially it was a form of escaping. For me, the stage was a safe place to hide in a character and express a lot of inner turmoil or anger or frustrations or sadness within a character. It's hard as a man in a small agricultural town to ultimately have all these emotions, and it's not really kind of an accepted thing. It's like, you're a guy, you don't cry. This, you know, there's all these sort of stigmatisms to emotions as a guy in a small town. So I hid in all these characters and like expressed all these feelings I was having. And then it came, I lost this sort of therapy in it and kind of moved on to human behavior and started studying psychology and human behavior and sociology. And that became an art form to me.
Now you've made it so big. Would you do a Broadway play?
I would. I mean, I've always wanted to do theater. I never want to abandon theater. It's just that it takes a lot of work, man. It takes a lot of time, but there's a huge payoff for it. But it, for me right now, I don't have that time. But I'll find time. It'll come.
Yeah.
It'll come.
All right. It was your big break, Hurt Locker?
One of them, a very big one, yes. I mean, I think there's been several milestones for me personally.
What was the first?
First one was my very first job. My very first job gave me my goals that I wanted coming down here to feel like I was a working actor. And I wanted to be in a movie. I wanted to be in a movie that was big enough to play in my small hometown in Modesto, and to be in a role in that movie that I wouldn't have to tell my parents, oh, I'm the guy in the red shirt during the nude scene in the pool, like
what
whatever.
What movie was it?
It was called National Lampoon Senior Trip, and it was my very first job ever. And, you know, it's a silly little, you know, Lampoon movie, and I don't judge it. It was a very important time for me, and it gave me a lot of confidence, you know, being my first job. And it wasn't like I did like an under five or as a guest star or something. It was like the lead in this movie. And so that gave me a lot of confidence to continue, and then I had to reshift my goals to something else. And then I struggled a lot in and out for that next decade. And then Dahmer comes around, and that becomes a whole nother characters of that I would not normally have played at that point. And then because of that movie, which I'm saying this because that's why I ended up getting a decade later after Dahmer, was The Hurt Locker. I got cast in that because Kathryn Bigelow saw that movie and said, that's Will James in The Hurt Locker. Mark Boal, the writer, is like, what, are you crazy? I don't see how you see that. Jeffrey Dahmer playing, what? I don't get it. She's like, look how he played Jeffrey Dahmer and not what he did in the movie. Look how he played him. And I get what she meant by that. And then so I got that break doing that, which I thought to me, that should go to Russell Crowe, that role, you know. But she went my way, and like, you know, I was very thankful for that.
I used to do a lot of shows about Jeffrey Dahmer back on CNN. Mm. How did you find that character who not just killed people, but cannibalized them?
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know,
I mean, you can't deal with life experience.
No, but the blessing for my experience doing that was I really didn't know a whole lot about him. So I didn't have a lot of preconceived ideas or judgments about him. Well, it's easy to judge a man by once you find out, oh, wow, he did that and that and that and that and that. But it was all brand new to me, so I had to ultimately find out in a psychological way what drives this person? What is the fuel for this person? I can't look at what he does because, you know, that's easy to pass judgment on because I have to play this guy, you know,
and he
as
likes
a human.
Himself, right?
Yeah, but there's a lot of, you know, abandonment issues. I mean, there's a lot to go to, like, very, very deep, sad things where, you know, relationship with his father, Lionel, and then the disconnect there and then being gay and not knowing how to tell your father you're gay. And so it goes inward. And, I mean, this went into dark, dark places. Don't get me wrong. It's all dark, and it really kind of screwed me up for a while. But to try to make any sense out of that was challenging, and it was a wonderful experience, actually.
Next, Jeremy, on upcoming blockbusters, including Avengers and Age of Ultron, is it?
Age of Ultron, yes.
And then, of course, a lot we'll talk about his wonderful new movie, Kill the Messenger. Don't go away. We're back with Jeremy Renner. He stars in Kill the Messenger. It opens October 10th. Wide, as they say. This is going to be a big movie. It's going to be a big movie.
Oh, wow. Hope so.
Now, tell me about the Avengers Age of Ultron. How did the Avengers come to you?
Well, that was a while ago. I think Iron Man had just come out, and then someone said, you should be great Hawkeye. So I went, Kevin Feige, there was, again, no script. This is a long time ago. And I said, I really like this guy, because he wasn't really a superhero. He's just a guy with a high skill set. So I'm like, okay, I can understand that. I can wrap my brain around that. I'm not flying around. I don't have a hammer or whatever. I'm not smashing things. I'm like, oh, wait, this guy is just good at what he does. So I'm like, okay, I'll do it. And then ends up, you know,
going through the roof.
Yeah, just going bananas. I don't think anybody expected to do it doing that well, but wow.
So this next one is number what?
This is going to be the second one. And I just saw little snippets of it at the Comic-Con thing that they do. It's a wonderful thing. Like, for me, like, I played a lot of bad guys and villains, and I do heavy movies and dramas. And because I did the Avengers, now I have, like, five-year-olds run up to me. And that is the coolest thing ever, by the way. The coolest thing. Yeah. I mean, the innocence of a child running up to you, like, with a little bow and arrow, they want you to sign a thing, or it's a Captain's Shield, whatever it is. It's a...
It's a lovely thing.
Is it going to be a constant thing for you? I mean, you don't die in this one.
No. I don't die. I think they want to keep you around for a while.
When you're working with all that talent at Robert Downey Jr., Scarlett Johansson, mm-hmm. Chris Evans, Elizabeth Olsen, is that, do you do better when you're with better people?
The best thing about that experience on those kind of movies where it's not very challenging is an actor, and those are all really proper, good actors. It's the cast that makes it fun. And mind you, we're not doing Shakespeare or anything really, you know, uber challenging for any of that caliber of actor, but we have a lot of fun. And yeah, when you work with somebody that's really talented, I mean, we're doing 1-2 takes and we're out of there. I mean, okay, we got that. We're done, we're moving on.
But Anthony Quinn told me once that no matter what the role, if he is Zorba the Greek, mm-hmm. or it's a light fit, you give your 100%.
Sure.
Is that true?
Sure, yeah.
But it's not the scale of, say, Kill the Messenger.
It doesn't require as much. So you don't have to go as deep as in Hawkeye. You don't have to, like, really ultimately go that far. I try to help the director tell the story for the movie. It's that simple.
So you're giving it 100%.
100%. Yeah.
How did you get Mission Impossible?
Oh, that's an interesting story, actually. I went in to go meet J.J. Abrams for Super 8, I believe the movie was.
Yeah, I remember that movie.
And I was in there to tell him, and I really wanted to work with him, and we were talking about doing it or not, and then he says, you know what, I'm producing this other movie, you might be better for it. Even though I want you in this movie, you want to go meet Tom? I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, you like Mission Impossible? I'm like, yeah, those are great movies. Do you want to meet Tom right now? I'm like, yeah. Where is he? He's like, he's over here. He calls him up, go over there, meet Brad Bird, and half hour later, I'm like, I guess now I'm doing Mission Impossible. And
that was a fun role. I mean, that was a lot of athleticism.
Yes, but I didn't know any of these things. I mean, I was sitting at a table not like this with Brad Bird and a producer and Tom Cruise, and they're telling me about kind of what the movie is. Maybe they know what the movie is, I don't know. But all I can say is like, why do you want me in this? I don't get it. Why should I do something? I don't get it. I don't want, why me? And they're not somebody else. He's like, here's why. Boom, 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 boom. He said three things. I'm like, that makes sense. Okay, yes, I'll do your movie.
He's one of the hardest working people.
Oh, right? I think the hardest.
You do 20 takes, 30 takes, right?
I don't think it's about the amount of takes. It's about what that guy, he sleeps probably like 2 hours a day. He does so many things. And he's so giving and generous. I don't know where he gets the time or the energy to do all he does in a day. It's fascinating to me.
Is he an underrated actor? Because he gets so much publicity off the screen.
It depends on who you ask. And for me, no. I mean, I have a lot of respect for him as an actor. I mean, geez, I've seen how many of his movies? 30? I mean, a lot.
Yeah, me too.
And then working with him, no, I don't think he's underrated as an actor, no.
Tell me about The Town, one of my all-time favorite movies.
Yeah.
That was a great character.
That was a great character. And I turned it down. I'm like,
really?
I don't want to play a bad guy. I don't get it.
But you were a bad good guy.
Yeah. But initially when I read it, I'm like, maybe I should play the FBI guy, the John Hamm role. I'm like, maybe it's that one.
We hated him.
I don't know. Yeah, exactly. But this is like all in the beginning of the process. I'm like, all right, I'll go in and I'll read this thing. I don't know Boston at all. I've never been there. So I sat down with Ben at a table, not unlike this.
And I'm like, he's like, there's always a table.
Yeah, there's always a table. And it's very, very, you know, casual. And like, let's just read through these scenes. And I'm like, all right, let me just do a New York accent because I can't do a bar. I don't know that. I don't want to screw this up. So he's did the thing. And he's like, yeah, it's great. Da, da, da. And, you know, Ben's very affable. And so I'm sort of interviewing him. I just kind of turned it on. I'm like, so why do you think you can direct and star in this movie? I mean, look, I love Gone Baby Gone and all.
I did,
but
too.
Like, what, you know, you were just directing that. Now you're starring in it and going to direct it? Like, okay. And his answer is the reason why I did the movie. And he said he didn't know. He said, I don't know how I'm going to do it. But what I have done is I've asked other friends of mine that are directors and they've starred in their own film and found the pitfalls and the things with the Godfather. And the guy, look, Ben is one of the smartest guys I know and one of the most charming guys I know. And that's very apparent. So I said, yes, because he didn't know the answer, I'll absolutely follow you.
Jeremy is tackling what many are calling maybe his toughest role yet, that of the late journalist Gary Webb. We'll learn all about Kill the Messenger next. We're back with Jeremy Renner. I had the pleasure yesterday of seeing Kill the Messenger. Tell me how this came about for you.
I remember I was in New Mexico shooting the Avengers, and the script came my way, and I read it during lunch. I'm like, I'm getting halfway through and being like, oh, wow, this is great. And I'm like, oh, does it need to be on a big screen? So my business partner's like, just finish it, just read it, and we'll talk later. So I do finish it, and I'm like, okay, well, I get it. We have to tell the story. We've got to tell the story, and for a lot of reasons. And then I read the book. I met with Peter Landesman, who wrote the script. It was really terrific. And then we just started thinking of a game plan of how to, you know, get this movie made.
This is a true story. You show Dan Rather and people, newsmen, and as it outlined, this is when the CIA financed drug sales for Iran-Contra. Mm. A story that broke.
Yes.
Almost lost Gary. He went through terrible times. Yep. They killed the messenger.
Yeah.
And then it kind of died.
Yep.
And then it was revealed that he was right all along.
Right.
And that got buried.
Yeah. Frustrating.
Well, how, putting it together, what was it like to work on?
Well, I mean, I had to dive into, I'm usually on the opposite side of journalists, so it was nice to kind of dive into a lot of people I'm with all the time to investigative reporting, journalism, it was interesting. And to understand the relationship with editors, I had to understand the relationship with his family. The things that were important to Gary, I focused on. The story itself, I don't think anybody's ultimately ever gonna figure out or take responsibility for. There's a lot of rabbit holes with Dark Alliance, but the main reason why I wanted to go do it because Gary Webb was flawed, and he is our hero, if you will, of the picture. And I love heroes with flaws, and with his infidelities or his in his writings that are maybe oversimplified or spoken in hyperbole where, you know, could be room for misinterpretation. But he's right. He was right. And everybody that knows it, but everybody that should know it doesn't know it yet, and hopefully they will October 10th.
Now, you really got into him.
Yeah, you have to, you know.
I mean, you were terrific. You're going to get another nomination.
I don't know. I don't know.
I think you will.
Well, that's very kind to say.
I predict this. You will get another nomination. You deserve it.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. It was a lot of work, and that's exactly what I was looking for. A lot of responsibility, a lot of weight, and a complicated character, and I was blessed with Gary Webb's plight.
Gary Webb died under mysterious circumstances?
Yeah, we didn't want to weigh in too heavy with that because I think it would undermine all the story, because we shot a really beautiful artistic scene of, because there's a morgue shot of him with two gunshots to his head. And we had it and did this thing, and it's a beautiful piece of cinema, but it ended up being too heavy-handed on like where one might lie because we're spinning. I think just a little tag at the end, let the audience kind of run with it.
And picture of him with his family.
Yeah, that was more important than like seeing dead in the morgue.
He was a very conflicted character. I would have liked to have known him. I thought we almost had him for an interview on CNN.
Oh, yeah.
I think we had him booked and then something happened.
Oh, wow, that would have been great.
Because he did a lot of shows.
He did a lot of shows, yeah. He's very, very well spoken. Had a great sort of, you know, wry sense of humor to him. And I wish I would have got to meet him.
It's amazing how that story went away, though, when he was proven right.
Yeah, you know, with the
10 years and the Hillary Clintons.
Yeah, it all came in decades, wouldn't it? Because by the time he got to Dark Alliance, you know, this is about something that happened 10 years prior, and then by the time in 2000, whatever it was, four, I can't even remember the dates, but the Lewinsky thing happens, and then that gets buried, you know, and he's dead and gone by then. So
page 8.
Yeah, yeah, deep.
What's next? The Avengers you've done, right?
Finish the Avengers Age of Ultron. Promote this movie with a big smile on my face, happily.
Build a house.
Building a house, get a roof for my family, and then go off to do Mission Impossible in a week.
Oh, another
one. Yeah, going out to see Tom, going doing that again and for the rest of the year.
Where are they shooting that?
Looks like it's going to be Morocco somewhere and London.
And what character are you?
Still the same character.
Guy.
Yeah, still the same character. And you know, Chris McCoy is directing and writing. He's just a terrific writer, so I'm excited to work with him as a director. And we'll see what goes from there, you know.
How do you choose what you pick?
Well, within the, I mean, it's always really...
Mission Impossible's, the Avengers are, they have franchises.
Yeah, right? But you know, I'm still very particular about, even within that, especially within that, because you're going to have to repeat it. So it's got to be a character that's complicated enough
to want to continue doing it over and over again. But in general, like, I like to, like, you know, take Gary Webb. Well, this is an easy one because it's like, you know, he's flawed left and right, and it's complicated, and so it's kind of spelled out for me. So, but I like things that challenge me. I like to be challenged. If I have to go to work and I already know the answers, I'm already bored. I'm not going to turn in a good performance. I'm not going to get 100%. So I want to go and learn. I want to not know the answers. I'm willing to fail every day.
Well, you learned a lot in Kill the Messenger.
I did learn a lot.
After the break, Jeremy will take some of your social media questions. We'll play a game of You Only Knew. Stay with us.
You Only Knew.
We're back with Jeremy Renner. Don't forget, Kill the Messenger opens October 10th, and it is a terrific movie. I gave quotes to your people already.
Oh, great. Fantastic.
We were flooded with social media questions. Here are some. Hannah Swift on Facebook. I hear you play in a band. Where do you play, and how do you take the time to do it?
Well, I used to play in a band. Yeah, I don't have the time to do it, or I would be doing it. But yeah, it was called the Sons of Ben. It was a side project.
What band?
Called the Sons of Ben. The Sons of Ben. Yeah, it's a long story. Can't get into it. But yeah, it was an acoustic rock group. It was a side project for some rock stars and for me, and it was fun.
Ken Dawson on Facebook. What details, if any, can you tell us about the new Bourne movie? And for your first go-round, did Matt Dillon give you any tips?
Ah, well, probably Matt Damon, but... No, I didn't talk to him until after the fact. And any details of the new one...
When are you doing that?
They're still writing. That happens probably next summer. Next summer we'll be shooting that.
Like that character?
Yeah, the character's great, yeah.
Joe Meekum on Instagram wants to know, what has been the most difficult role you've taken and why?
Playing Jeffrey Dahmer was probably the most difficult because it's the furthest from who I am.
Did you shoot that in Milwaukee?
We shot a little bit actually in Milwaukee, yeah.
M. Boniar on Instagram, what if you could be the main character of a film already been, what is a, have you seen a film you'd have liked to have played?
Ooh, wow, I don't know.
Or is there a play you'd love to do?
Oh, there's a load of plays. I love a good old Sam Shepard play. I'd be into that every day of the week.
B.R. Whom V on Instagram. What time do you wake up? What time do you go to sleep? What's a typical Jeremy Renner day?
Well, nowadays, I get up right at 7 o'clock in the morning, and I'm in bed at probably midnight.
Matt, what's the family like? Yeah.
Oh, I get up with my daughter every morning. And start my day with her, and then end my day with her. She's 17 months.
Woo.
Yeah.
Natalie White on Facebook. What is your? Do you have a dream role?
Oh, I think if anything that I haven't done, that I'd really like to do is play some sort of like a Skinnerd story or something where it requires singing. I think fun. Yeah. I think that'd be something musical. Not that I want to do a musical necessarily, but something that sort of vocal challenge in a movie, in a film, would be great.
At Miranda Zero on Twitter, what surprised you the most about producing a movie you also starred in?
How easy it was.
Really?
Yeah, I thought it was going to be harder, but I think it's because I had a lot of people to lean on. And I think that's probably the best secret in producing is surround yourself with people that really know what they're doing. my parts in it were.
How much more do you shoot than we see? Like, it's a 2-hour movie.
It depends on the movie. And Kill the Messenger? Oh, it's, you know, like Hurt Locker, I think we shot 90 hour. I can't remember. It's something astronomically large. It's 4-1. Sometimes it's up to 90-1.
Kill the Messenger 4-1?
I don't remember how much actually film we shot on that accurately, but yeah, I mean, it's pretty typical, pretty typical.
We play a little game if you only knew. I just throw out questions.
Okay.
Remember the girl, first girl you kissed?
Yes.
What was her name?
What was her name? Brooke.
Brooke.
Yes.
Brooke. How old were you, Jeremy?
I was in third grade.
Was it at school?
It was at school, after school.
If not acting,
swing.
If not acting, then what?
Oh, wow. Music and home building and then music.
Dream co-star you haven't worked with?
Oh, jeez. Insert a long list of people. Haven't worked with. How about Meryl Streep?
Not bad.
Can I throw that out there?
I didn't ask about American Hustle. That must have been a riot.
Ah, it was a riot. Riot.
Best piece of advice you ever received?
Be willing to fail.
Advice for up-and-coming actors?
I say don't have a plan B. I think you're planning to fail.
Biggest splurge? What have you just whacked out on?
I can't say that. A vehicle, actually. I got an electric vehicle. I spent a lot of money on that. And I've never, my first new car, by the
Which
way.
Which one?
I've never owned a new car. My
Tesla?
Life. Yeah, just got the Tesla.
Yeah, great car.
A year ago. And it's the first time at 41, I got a brand new car.
Got friends who have, they love that car.
It's a beautiful car.
Funniest fan encounter?
I think in Germany, it was probably like 5-6 in the morning, and there was a guy dressed up as Hawkeye, but in a very homemade costume, with this cardboard bow and arrow and this ridiculous cardboard purple tights on, and Hawkeye, it was amazing. It was amazing. It was a great way to wake up and start my day.
You have a secret talent. Is there a talent you have we don't know about?
I don't know.
Well, singing.
Singing? Yeah, okay.
Favorite superhero growing up?
I was probably like a Spider-Man kid.
Biggest prankster on the set of the Avengers?
Ooh, that was everybody. That was Downey. That was Ruffalo. Mark Ruffalo, big time. Chris
He's
Evans.
A great actor.
Yeah, he's terrific.
Thing that keeps you up at night?
Ooh. Things that aren't done.
Something no one knows about you.
That I'm nice.
Music,
I'm a softy.
Music currently on your iPad. iPod.
On my iPod. I just downloaded an older album. It's Third World. It's an old reggae band that I kind of grew up with. I'm like, I'm revisiting some music that's kind of timeless. It's quite beautiful.
Jeremy Renner in 10 years.
Is still breathing.
Thank you, man. Great having you with us.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
A huge thanks to my guest, Jeremy Renner. Be sure to catch his newest film, the terrific Kill the Messenger, out in theaters October 10th. You can always find me on Twitter @KingStones.